Hey, everybody. Thanks for tuning in to Lessons with Troy, the podcast. I'm your host, Troy Brenningmeyer. This week, my guest is the UK-based Weissenborn player Barney Kenny. Barney takes what is normally a quiet, mellow instrument and puts it right at the forefront of his rock band, the Dustbowl Children. Adding overdrive, wah-pedal, and other effects, he is redefining the sound of the traditional Weissenborn-style hollow-neck guitar. In this interview, I wanted to get his fresh perspective of not only the Weissenborn and lap slide style playing, but also his take on the music industry and the highs and lows of being in an up-and-coming rock band in the UK. I'll also be playing tracks off their newly released EP called Hollow Lands. Be sure to check them out on Facebook at facebook.com/thedustbowlchildren. Also, if you're interested in learning more about playing Weissenborn, lap steel, dobro, or pedal steel, be sure to check out my site, lessonswithtroy.com, where you'll find lots of downloadable video lessons and lots of free samples, too. Right now, here's my interview with Barney Kenny, and be sure to stick around to hear tracks off their new EP. Hi, welcome to Lessons with Troy, the podcast. I'm Troy Brenningmeyer. Well, in this week's podcast, I'm happy to welcome Barney Kenny from the group The Dustbowl Children. And he's coming to us all the way from across the ocean there in the UK. Devon, I believe, is the town he's at in the UK. So let's go ahead and welcome Barney Kenny from the Dustbowl Children. How's it going, Barney?
Nice. How are you doing?
Good, good.
Yeah, really good. Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Yeah, so tell our listeners and viewers, you know, a little bit about yourself and about your band and kind of what you do. I know you play lap steel and Weissenborn too in your group, right?
Yeah. I play just the Weissenborn, but we play kind of like a rock style. So I put it through a little amp and chuck the crunch on it, and it's a great sound. Yeah, a lot of wah-pedal and a lot of effects. So kind of a different take on the traditional hollow neck.
Nice. Now, well, the first thing that comes to my mind initially when you talk about, you know, playing Weissenborn and putting overdrive and everything, I mean, how do you get around the feedback issue on stage with that?
It is a problem a lot of the time. Heavy sound checks, getting the effects levels fine off of the pedals, and also getting the balance with the amp as well. We've started using like a 2-amp setup for me and the other guitar players. So we've got sort of 2 amps each, so we have sort of a stereo effect on the stage, which is kind of cool. So we kind of put the wah first through one and then the effects next, so it does help. But yeah, I mean, on the model I'm using, I've got a Fishman pickup.
Okay.
So the feedback's not too bad on that one, but on my other model, I have to sort of block the sound hole with a bit of card. So yeah, that kind of works. It's a bit of a botched job, but it does the trick. So yeah.
Nice. And what kind of Weissenborn are you playing?
At the moment, I play a guitar by a company called Underwood Guitars.
Oh yeah, sure.
They're based over here in the UK. They're kind of a worldwide shipper of they're gorgeous instruments. Really, really lovely. I've got two. My primary one at the moment is an AW series, and it's kind of a little bit deeper than my first one. So the action's a lot higher, and it's just a lot warmer tone. The wood's different, and it's gorgeous. Like acoustically, in like a lovely major tuning, it's just a real joy to play, and then it just works so great through the amp as well for band. So yeah, I cannot complain one bit.
Very cool. Well, you know, the other thing that I was going to ask you too is just to tell our listeners a little bit about your band and you know, if they haven't heard of your band, you know, maybe a little history. Yeah. And so
yeah, sure. So we are in our sort of second year now. We've been going since, must be 2014. We kind of all met down in Falmouth, which is in Cornwall in the UK, so the southern tip of the UK, sort of where we stick out towards the bottom of Ireland, and that's where we're based now, so Cornwall and Devon. And yeah, we're gigging a lot around there, just getting the name out. We're unsigned, so it's probably why like we haven't got quite a lot out there. But the last year has been a big one for us, because we've hit like 1,000 likes on Facebook. We're just releasing new music this week, and yeah, we're just really gradually getting sort of promoters on our side early over in the UK. So to do this sort of thing and get across the pond is really important for us, because we'd love to crack the US at some point. So we're doing all right.
very cool. Well, you know, the other thing too that I would love to talk to you about is just, you know, to get your perspective as someone who's starting up a band, you know, relatively new, and just kind of your views of the music industry, and you know, how I mean, when I was, I'm gonna sound old or something, but when I was growing up, you know, you'd do it a little bit different. You'd get a record deal and this and that. Now it's completely different. I mean, Spotify and iTunes and all these different streaming plays. What's your views of all that kind of stuff?
I think streaming is great. I'm not going to lie. I think it's a really good way of getting the music out there if you're not too fussed about sort of the financial element of it, because obviously it's a lot different than going out there selling your music or selling it from your own site or something. But personally, I think it's, in my opinion, as like both solo and with a band, like having a music streamable for everyone everywhere is just so important. And it's such a change in the way that things have gone, like as you were saying earlier, like to have that service now in the sort of modern era of music, so to speak, is vital to have your stuff streamable, to send it across the globe in a heartbeat, to have somebody that can listen to it at any point, anywhere, at the tip of, you know, the tip of the fingers is so great. But in the same sense, like, not enough people get out and do it for themselves, which is something that I know in Dustbowl we really pride ourselves on, is that we gig a lot and we get out there and we still do it sort of old school. Because there's so many people that, like, we know a couple of people that sort of land a record deal, and because they've got this kind of niche little song that the record company's picked up, and we say, oh, that was great, you guys must have worked really hard, and go, oh, we've sort of only ever done like three shows, and it's kind of like, oh man, really? I do this like three times a week. And yeah, I think it's so important to engage with, like, face to face with fans and just meet people and talk to people, because that's the way you sort of network these days. Is like, it's great to have social media and social networking, but to do it with real people is still so important. Like, to me as a musician, to interact with people is the only way to really get true fans, I think.
True. Yeah. Yeah. I agree. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Spotify, I just recently in the last year or so, started a subscription to that, and it's just it's just so easy to use. You know, I mean, I just dialed up something on my phone, you know, right before we started to, you know, check out all your stuff. And
I mean, it's just there.
It's there. Yeah. And you don't have to worry about losing CDs or scratching them or,
Exactly. I mean, this time around, like, with our last release, which was like a lot folkier, and like that was mainly sort of my own writing, and this next release this week is solely sort of writing as a band. So with that one, like, I think putting it online was kind of cool for me, just to hear it. It's like everyone could just get hold of my stuff, and it was great. But with that one, we just ordered so many CDs. And we were like, oh, we'll sell them all at gigs. It'd be great. It'd be brilliant. And we did like a 10-day tour, and we sold about 40 out of the 200 that we got. And everyone's like, it's fine, man. I'll just get it. I'll just get it online. I'll get it on Spotify. It's like, oh, cheers, man. So it's kind of like swings and roundabouts, really. It's great because everyone can go home and listen to you, but then they kind of think, oh, I can go home and listen to them for free.
Yeah.
So it's sort of, I don't mind either way. Like, it's cool to have a CD. Like, I'd buy a CD from a couple of guys that I saw in the pub that I liked. So it's kind of, it's nice to see when people do pick up your stuff everywhere. It's great. Like, people say, oh, I just heard you online. It's great. It's like, oh, cool. So you found me. I didn't have to do much for you to find me. And then they'll come see a show. So yeah.
Nice.
I'm off.
Yeah. Yeah. It definitely makes it more convenient. But then again, I know that, you know, there has to be a trade-off to the artist, I would think, especially starting off. You know, where you're not making that kind of money up front until you kind of get, I would think, just thousands and thousands of people listening on Spotify. But then it gets your name out there, so it's kind of,
yeah. I mean, you sort of can have a million plays on Spotify and sort of not really make anything, whereas you can then go and play to sort of 200 people or 100 people in in a club and sell 20 CDs and you'd make more than your million on Spotify. So it's kind of like, what would you rather?
Yeah.
It's tough, but it's fun. Like, gigging is so important, and it just really, I think it forms a band, and it makes a band. Like, if you're good on the record, that's great. And if you're good live, then you're a great band, I think.
Nice.
It's a real test.
Well, who are some of your influences, playing, I'm just going to call it lap style guitar, because it.
Yeah. Cool. I mean, it's so difficult because I've never really listened to a lot of lap style guys before I started working for Underwood, the company. So, I mean, I got a couple of mates over here that are like 10 years older than me, and they've sort of been playing it before I did. So I watched them at a couple of festivals and I thought, oh man, that's cool. That's really cool. I'd love to get into that. So I think I've only been playing it for two and a half years now.
Oh, really?
So yeah. I've been sort of guitaring for a long time. And I was always sort of a rock and roll blues guitar player. But then I went off to uni and I was like, okay, everyone's a guitar player. I'm not standing out really. Like, you can be great and not really stick out. So I thought, like, I still love playing electric guitar, but what is there that I can do where there's sort of no one else is doing it to make a stand out? And I thought, like, this lap steel business is kind of cool.
Yeah.
Like, because I'm a folk player as well, so the hollow body especially, it doubles as sort of my primary thing. So I can take it to solo shows and play folk and grassroots stuff, and then I can take it to a band show and stick it through the amp, and everyone's like, oh man, what's that? That's awesome. And that's what's so great for me personally as a player at the gigs, is everyone, no matter how big or small the show is, someone will come up to you and go, man, that is awesome. Like, what is that instrument? You're like, oh, well, I'll chat to you for a bit about this. It's like, you can just do so much with it.
Yeah.
And if you like a guitar and not as sort of this sort of gentle, fragile thing, because, like, same with anything, like, if you buy an instrument or like a camera or a phone, like, if you're soft with it, then it doesn't really, like, get any character. And people that sort of bubble wrap their instruments, I've never been all for that. I'm sort of like, you just chuck it around a bit, it'll be fine. It's not gonna, it's not gonna break unless you really kick it. So, I mean, mine are a little bit battered and broken at times.
Hey, give some character. Yeah, my dad always mentions Willie Nelson's guitar. You know how it has the hole in it, and it's all scraped up and everything.
One guitar, I think. Was it Willie Nelson that had just that bit of pipe as his bottleneck, and he just used that for like his whole career, like just one bit of pipe. Man, you can't find that. Like Dwayne Allman's pill bottle. Come on.
That's great. Oh man.
To be honest, it's only since I started playing lap steel that I've been looking into lap steel artists. Like, I would never have come across like Ben Harper or Xavier Rudd if I hadn't first started the instrument. So it's kind of backwards for me.
Yeah. What's some of the, with you just kind of, in the last few years, playing this, what's some things that you struggle with the instrument? I mean, the instrument's so technically challenging, to get the intonation and everything right.
Oh, I mean, something that is quite interesting to me, and I've only just picked up on it, is that most of the guys that I play with in the UK that play the lap steel, they kind of use the little shub slides,
mm-hmm.
kind of small ones. And I've been using, I personally, for me, I use the Robert Randolph, the RR2.
Okay, yeah.
Like a pedal steel slide. So it's like a good half an inch longer, and it's so dense. And it's not curved at the end, so there's no intonation. You can't. There's no bend, so it's not designed for individual stuff. It's just purely for bars. And I kind of think that's given me a bit of an edge, because I can reach across the whole fretboard at time. And whereas most of the guys are sort of playing the chords on the lower three, but I can kind of get across everything and get a bit more of bit more range out of it. When I do play, I leave the top string open, like the high D, I leave it open when I play a lot of the time. So it kind of has this chorus effect, which is quite nice. But intonation-wise and individual notes, I play a lot of the lead lines on the high strings anyway. So, yeah, a lot of hammer-ons mainly. And combining it with the wah-pedal kind of gives you a bit of an edge. You can kind of mask over any sort of mistakes if you get your sort of intonation on the pedal right. So I kind of get away with it.
Nice, nice. It's more of a vibe thing probably too, to just get the energy levels up, you know.
Absolutely. But it's different when you play, when I play solo anyway, because then it's just unplugged and clean. And I play a lot sort of more ballady type things, so there's a lot more chord based on the lap steel and a lot more, not as crazy and not as many hammer-ons.
nice. Well, cool. Well, tell our listeners a little bit, you know, a lot of the listeners, it's probably, or viewers, you know, on YouTube, they're on this side of the pond, so to speak. What's life for you like living in the UK and having a band in the UK?
Yeah. It's great. Like we're gigging on time. We're good in a certain area, but I mean, I'd love to come over and gig there, because the gigging life here is so difficult to, if you want to make a living out of it. Like, you can gig wherever you like, but it's either going to cost you or you're not going to make the money. So finding paying gigs is it takes time. Like, we're just about now getting into the point where we can make a relatively all right amount of money off of a week's gigging. But sort of, we've done so many free shows. Like, we've traveled for free shows, like a long way. Well, I say it's a long way for the UK. we've gone from Cornwall to London and back for sort of a 20-minute free show, because we thought it would be worth it. And we've done that a couple of times, and we're just like, now it's, we've come to the decision that we just don't find it's worth going to the city, to London, to do anything, because no one pays you unless it's a great venue or you're signed.
Really? Okay.
So, yeah. A lot of the time it's pay to play, actually.
Oh, wow.
So it's, yeah, so it's like, oh, yeah, you can come play, but you have to sell like 90 tickets. And it's like, well, we're based 4 hours away. We don't have a fan base there. Like, we can't fork out this amount of money for tickets that we're not going to sell, and then lose money and lose petrol money. And it's just like, it's so much hassle to do it at the stage where no one's managing you and you're doing it all yourself. So I think the next stage for us is just trying to get some sort of agency deal or management deal, and we can just break through the ceiling that we kind of need to get to the next point at.
Yeah.
So we're totally 100% self-managed, self-promoted. Everything's done by us, and it's really tiring. It's really tiring at times. Like, you sort of get to the end of the week and you're like, oh man, so I didn't really get much done this week, but I've got something in the pipeline for 2 weeks' time. And it's like, there's a lot of planning and it's a lot of effort, but when you get to the gig and it's good and the people are there and they're loving it, it makes it worth it. But I think for the band, the next point is literally just getting on someone's books and getting to the next stage, really.
Yeah. Now, would that next stage be like an opening gig, you know, for a bigger band or a festival gig?
Yeah, exactly. What the goal is to get on like a support tour for someone big. So sort of an opening slot on like a sort of European leg of a tour, or just like 4 or 5 dates for a big crowd and a big, like, biggish band. I think that's where we want to get to for now, in the next sort of year or so.
Nice. Now, who are some of the bands that you like from the UK? I know myself, and we had mentioned this, we had chatted on Facebook to some of the viewers. We had chatted on Facebook, and a band that I really like, I'm a huge Foo Fighters fan, but they had an opening group called Royal Blood, I think was the name of the group.
We like Royal Blood. We do like Royal Blood. They're such a huge sound for a two-piece. It's insane. They're kind of like Black Keys, just on illegal substances. It's so much sound. Like, you forget the guy's playing a bass. Like, it's insane.
Yeah.
But I didn't even think about it until I watched them on YouTube. I was like, that is a bass. How has he done that?
And he's very secretive too. Like, I got on some, I had to get on forums and everything. Yeah. And literally people have like pictures of his pedals, and they're like, I think he's doing this with this pedal. And
it's crazy.
Yeah. He won't tell. He won't tell about his gear. You know, he's real secretive about it.
I bet it's not a big secret. I bet it's really easy. But what he's doing is just, like, oh yeah, I've just got one drive pedal. That's it. It's just none of these I've been.
Yeah.
No, I'd love to see them. Because our drummer actually went to the Foo's show over here, where it was Iggy Pop, Royal Blood, and Foo's. And he was like, oh man, it was awesome. Apparently it was epic.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Well, yeah, that sort of we always talk about like opening for someone like Royal Blood. Like, wow, that'd be great. That'd be really insane.
Well, that's what I thought of when I first heard your the hook, you know, which we're actually, this would probably be a good point to play this song.
Give it up.
Yeah, but that's the sound that I was like, wow, that has that real driving sound to it. So, yeah, why don't we go ahead? Oh, go ahead.
Instrumental we'd written. So, yeah. Let's give it a go.
And I think I might have cut you off. What'd you say right then?
I said that's our first instrumental that we've ever written. And we kind of wanted to put some words to it, but we said, it sounds really cool just on its own. Like, it doesn't really need much because the guitars are kind of playing the melody line anyway. And like when we play it live, we kind of get the crowd kind of doing the lines anyway. So it works really cool. It's a nice break middle of the set just to sort of rest with vocals a bit.
Nice. Well, here's the Dustbowl Children featuring Barney Kenny on the Weissenborn, right? Plugged in, nice. Electrified, lots of testosterone. And this is their song called The Hook. Hope you enjoy it. Welcome back. We're talking with Barney Kenny from the group The Dustbowl Children, and I wanted to talk a little bit about his band's new EP that's coming out. Now, what's the title of this, and tell us a little bit about it.
Yeah, sure. So the title of the EP is called Hollowlands, and that's actually the title track of the EP is called that. So I wrote it about a year ago on a little nylon acoustic, and it kind of had this sort of Indian vibe. So I took it to band and was like, okay, yeah, what do we want to do with this? So I put it on the electric guitar, And I had these lyrics on the back burner about, because I live on Dartmoor in the UK, and it's kind of like this open, barren, like expanse of hills and rocks, but it's quite a barren place. And I thought, like, I'll put this sort of Indian feel on like a Devon influence, and it's worked really well. Like, we have this really huge outro with a great guitar solo, and yeah, it's a great track. And it's a bit of an epic. It's like 5.5 minutes, but it's awesome. So there's no lap steel on that, but it's a pretty epic tune. So we're really happy with it. It should be on iTunes within the next couple of weeks. So yeah, it'll
very
be
cool,
up and ready.
Well, why don't we listen to another song too? And this is going to be on this new EP, you're saying, right? Hollow Lens, all these songs that we're demoing on this podcast,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Cool, yeah, very cool.
There's three lap steel tracks on there. The hook, Driving, and a track called Bad Plans. And the other two are just our sort of straight up electric guitar. But yeah, those are the three Weissenborn tracks on the EP, so yeah.
Nice. And actually, you know, we didn't even talk about the hook. Let's talk a little bit about that, the one that we just listened to.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about the recording process. What's going on behind the scenes with that?
Okay, so it's quite funny actually. We were invited in to do a live lounge session for BBC Radio, and they were like, okay guys, you need like three songs, and we wanted to use the lap steel because it's such a cool like selling point and people talk about it on the radio. It's like, okay, we need like three songs that we can do an arrangement, like an acoustic arrangement for the radio. So we did a cool version of Driving and an old song of ours called Downtown, which is kind of like a ZZ Top shuffle, like a Texas shuffle. And we did those two, and like, okay, we need something else. So we were kind of playing around with the riff from the hook, and we just sort of put it together, and it was a day before and we still hadn't finished it, and we were saying, oh, it needs some words. And then we sort of played through it a couple of times, and we're like, actually, it's really catchy as it is, and it's such a cool thing. Like, no bands really write like rock instrumentals, especially like from our neck of the woods anyway. So we're like, okay, so we've got slide, we've got a freaking awesome drum beat on it, and loads of cool parts, and a really great like catchy melody line, so we'll just keep it as an instrumental. And yeah, we've just sort of dropped it as a single, and yeah, it's got really good feedback.
Nice. Yeah, I love it.
Thanks, man.
And so let's listen to another one from the EP. Now this one is called Bad Plans, and maybe before we listen to it, tell us a little bit about that tune.
Okay, this was kind of the second song that we ever experimented with the wha-pedal on the lap steel. So I can't really remember how we got around to doing this one. Of a riff we were playing with in rehearsals, just sort of sound checking, and we're like, oh yeah, that's a really sweet riff. We can keep that and make it into a sort of radio length great track. And it's actually one we're going to send in to BBC this week to get that on the radio for next weekend. So yeah, the riff is just a straight up rock riff with a lot of heavy wah pedal. And the lyrics are kind of about sort of forbidden women that you shouldn't like, but you do. So there's this guy kind of likes this girl that he shouldn't like. She's kind of like a rock chick. And he's just like, oh, man, shouldn't like you, but I do. So, yeah, he has bad plans. So, yeah, we hope you like it.
Very cool. Here's Bad Plans, the Dustbowl Children. right, welcome back. We're talking to Barney Kenny from the group The Dustbowl Children. And I wanted to talk a little bit about something that always interests me. You know, I kind of taught my whole life, and I was never a musician that went out on the road or anything so much. Mm-hmm. But tell us a little bit, and our listeners a little bit about life on the road for a band that's up and coming.
Yeah, oh, that's great. We love it. It's stressful, but it's so much fun. Like, sticking everything in the car and cramming yourself in, because we're actually just going around sort of in like a hatchback. So we have 3-4 guitars, drums, and then 4 of us somehow in this sort of Corsa. So it's a bit mental, but it's great. It's great fun. As I say, at the moment we don't travel too far. So we're doing like 2-3 hours at a time. So it's a struggle. When you're in there, it gets a bit hot and sweaty, and people get a bit cross because like, oh man, I don't want to be stuck in the car anymore. It's not like we have a huge bus or a van, but I mean, when you get there and like unpack and you get ready for the show, like, it's awesome. I love it. Absolutely love it.
Nice. Nice. Well, we got a little, I'm missing your video now. Let's see.
There we go. I don't know what happened there. You got him?
Yeah. Yep. Okay. Yep. Now you're coming back.
Cool.
Very cool.
Again.
So you're in, let me just kind of paint the picture here. So you're in a hatchback with 4 guys.
Mm-hmm.
You've got, I mean, I'm just thinking, are you pulling a trailer? You must be pulling a trailer, no. Right? Or no, no. Trailer?
It is like, do you ever play Tetris?
Oh, yeah.
It's literally Tetris. It's down to a fine art. Like, it's insane. Because our drummer, George, he's had to buy like a kit that's like just for Dust Bowl, because it's a lot. This kit's awesome. I love it. It's a lot smaller. I think it's a Gretsch or a Ludwig or something. I think it's Ludwig. But, it's awesome. It's like the kick is like a floor tom, and then toms sort of one up, one down job. It's awesome. It sounds huge, which is so weird for such a little thing. But yeah, so that's the hardware bag goes in the boot first, and then the drums go on top of that, and then guitars go on top of that. I mean, when we can get away with amp sharing, it's bliss, because like, we don't have to share any, you know, we don't have to bring our own amps, which is sometimes a bit of a faff, but like when there's space in the car, it's great. I mean, a trailer would be awesome, a van would be ideal, but yeah, it's a laugh. Like, we're sort of sitting under Fender Champs and Orange bass amps all the time, so we're putting in the air. So it's a laugh. We love it that much.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's great. And it makes for you know, down the road, great stories too,
yeah.
I'm sure.
When we finally get the big bus. Like.
That's right.
Reminisce about the Vauxhall.
So are you doing these shows and then, like, say you drive to London, are they putting you up, or are you having to just kind of...
Man, like, so much. We actually, in 2 years, we've had 2 gigs where they've given us accommodation. So we've set, and one was last week. It was our second one in 2 years that we've got a bed. It was bliss. And we're like, everyone can have a drink and we can just chill out. And we don't have to worry about going home, hotel. So yeah, that's another thing. Like, it's different over here for a gigging band in the UK. Like, a lot of the time you don't get sort of a rider, or a lot of the time you wouldn't get like a hotel. You have to do it under your own steam, sort of thing. So even getting like a couple of free beers is a challenge sometimes. So yeah, we've had some bad ones. Must be.
Oh man, you're paying your dues though. When it finally breaks, you're gonna enjoy it so much.
Yeah, I mean, like, there's been gigs where we've been paid, and then our bar tab's been more than we've been paid. So it's like, what have I done to myself? But yeah, it's all fun, and you learn from it.
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely. Well, very cool. Well, are you any plans on doing any European
yeah stuff? There are plans, nothing's booked, but that's something we're desperately looking into, booking some sort of Western Europe stuff. So maybe go to like Paris, Netherlands, Germany. We'd love to do it this summer, but nothing's booked in at the moment. But yeah, it's definitely in the pipeline. Definitely.
Nice. Yeah, so it's always
like
been...
A lot of the guys on the lap steel circuit in the UK sort of do a really good sort of Germany and the Netherlands. It's quite a big, like, people like it out there a lot, and it's a whole new crowd. Like, over here, we sometimes find that people just aren't really engaged with the music that we're playing. So we'd love to get out there and sort of play like a sort of German beer festival or like something just totally different and see how it goes down. Because I think when we have played some like festivals and stuff, we've got sort of the foreigners coming in from the have come down for the weekend, coming over for the weekend, and they're like, oh man, yeah, that's really cool. Like, we love that sort of stuff over like in Germany or in Holland. Like, oh, awesome. We'll come out there.
Yeah. That's what I always picture. You know, there's a group I like called the Infamous String Dusters, and I have a poster. I used to have it hanging up in my studio, but it was their German tour. And if you get on YouTube, you can see it's kind of when they were starting off, you know, they filmed this all, I think is their banjo player filmed all this, edited it, and it just made it look so cool, you know, to tour. They, I guess, is one summer they just toured all these beer festivals in Germany, you know.
Yeah, I think that's definitely something that we're gonna look into, because I mean, it's been so hard for us getting stuff because we've had such a break in recording, like, and the style since our first EP, the style has just changed. It's like a whole different band. Like, we were, because we keep forgetting, like, been playing and rehearsing and writing for so long, and we keep forgetting that no one else has heard it. So it's all in our heads, like, oh man, why aren't we getting these shows? It's like, oh, it's because nothing's out online. Like, it's because we haven't got anything out. And it's obviously, it's so difficult for us when we know that we'd slot in so perfectly to this like gap in the market, but obviously you wouldn't get booked if there's sort of nothing for them to hear. So that's why this release is so big for us. Like, it's just it's marking like a new chapter for us, getting it online and getting it ready to send to people, really.
Nice.
Yeah, so fingers crossed.
Well, what about, I know, like, with what I do, you know, I use YouTube a lot. Are you guys, have any plans in the future to really hit the video YouTube kind of place?
Started like filming whenever we go out to gigs and doing like a sort of road diary thing. So that's something we've just started doing this year. And we've got one out from one of our Devon shows down in Plymouth. And yeah, we're starting to sort of get into YouTube a bit more, because it's such a great platform, and it's so like underrated and so underused for like that sort of musician vlogging. Like, because obviously the YouTubers sort of take over quite a lot. Like, I'm quite big into watching the YouTubers and the daily vlogging style of things, but you don't see a lot of bands doing it. So it's kind of something that we'd like to do a lot more of, and we are starting to do a lot more of. So yeah, it's great. We've been filming sort of ourselves in the recording process and in the studio, and yeah, we might be able to sort of compile that all together into sort of, recording diary video vlog. So yeah, hopefully.
Nice.
Just the Dustbowl Children on YouTube. And then we've got a channel. We've not got really any subscribers, but we have got a few little videos up. So yeah.
So once again, it's just your YouTube profile name is what is it?
It's just the Dustbowl Children. It's just band name. And you should be able to find us pretty easily. There's videos of us at a place called the Convent Club and a couple of festival videos. So there's not much, but we are there. So.
Nice. Well, let's take another little break and let our listeners listen to the third tune that we're playing on this, and it's called Driving. Tell us a little bit about this tune.
Okay, so Driving is like an old favorite of ours. It was like the first point where we sort of really changed our style. We went from folk to rock in one song, and this was the one that sort of changed it for us. And it's got a lot of radio play over here in the UK. And yeah, this is the first time we used the wha-pedal on the lap steel. So this was a cool point for us. It's got like an Americana feel, actually. We always sort of imagine it being an American song because it's got a lot of American influences. It's sort of, in our heads, it's driving big open roads, Cadillacs, desert style. So yeah, it's a cool song for us to play. And it was the first time we put sort of like a dance beat sort of in the middle eight, and it gets things kicking. Like, we started putting it earlier on in the set rather than later, and it gets the mood really, really where we want it early on. So yeah, it's a great track.
Very cool. Here it is. Hope you enjoy it. This is, once again, Barney Kenny, the Dustbowl Children, and this is the tune called Driving.
100 dollar bills.
Welcome back. We're once again talking to Barney Kenny, and he plays with a group called the Dustbowl Children. I wanted to talk a little bit about your hometown. You said you're from Devon,
yeah,
in the UK. Talk to us a little bit about that, and kind of describe to our listeners what that town's like.
Okay, so me, our bass player, and the drummer, that's George and Pete. We actually all originally come from the same town, which is a little bit north of Devon and Cornwall. It's a place called Malmesbury, and it's just outside Bath and Bristol. So a couple of you guys might know the Bristol area. It's about 2 hours from London. And yeah, we've come down to Cornwall and Devon now, and we've really sort of related with the area with our music, and we thought this is sort of somewhere we think this music can really take off. So like George and Pete and Joe, they live in Cornwall in Falmouth, so on the sea. And I'm living up in Devon on Dartmoor at the moment. So it's a really special place for me. And it's somewhere I've visited a lot when I was a kid. And yeah, I didn't think I'd end up sort of living in the area. But that's happened. And I'm really happy about it. And it's such an inspirational place to write music as well. Just the history and the landscape, it's you don't find it anywhere else in England. So it's a privilege to live around here. Yeah.
Now, is it a small town? Is it a big town? Are there little pubs? More of a farming community?
Yeah. Yeah. Devon, Cornwall, they pride themselves on their little pubs. So yeah, I play a lot, a lot of folk gigs in the pubs, and then yeah, I love it. Little stone, low ceilings. That's brilliant. It's brilliant. Yeah, so Devon and Cornwall are counties, so they're kind of like small states for the UK.
Okay.
So, I live in a town called Tavistock at the moment, which is in Devon. And then the guys are living in a town called Falmouth in Cornwall. So, they're not big places. It's all very close together. we live about an hour and a half away from each other, so it's easy to get to, easy to gig. It's great.
Nice. Oh, looks like we lost the video again. Let's see.
Oh, there you go.
I think it's coming back. There it is. So, and this is just something that I'm curious about. You know, cause one day I want to visit England, and in my mind, it's probably something that I've probably seen in movies or something. But the small pubs, you know, with the locals that are always in there with the big pints of beer. But yeah. So I'm picturing you playing at these let's say a pub or something, mm-hmm. and you say you're playing folk music. What in England? What's a typical kind of pub gig like?
Well, with bands like a pub gig with Dustbowl is next to impossible. The volume is just too loud. You can't hear anything. But with you get a lot of pub acts are sort of cover bands, so they play a lot of like classic rock covers from UK, a lot of just general stuff people can sing along to. So you really cut your teeth in the pubs playing over here when you play your original music, because it's such a challenge, because you have to get people on board with your music. So you have to do a set that sort of has covers in it that you can get people with, but also enough covers that they don't mind listening to your originals. And then that's when you get them on board, really. So, I don't book shows for band in the pubs anymore, because the sound just doesn't quite fit. And like, you can't really experience the music as it should, because it's just too loud for a small pub. But for folk music, I play a lot of sort of unplugged sessions in Cayley's down in the pubs, and there's a lot of amazing folk players, a lot of great fiddle players, banjo players, a lot of great guitarists. And you can just share songs, and it's so lovely to play with a lot of just brilliant musicians that you wouldn't otherwise meet, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Now, are they kind of, I mean, is there a stage, or is this kind of more of a thing where you guys, more of a jam situation where you just pull up a chair?
Exactly, like a lot of these ones we do in Devon, like with when it's just me, like we just sort of go in, grab a beer, pull up a chair, and then sit there for sort of 4 hours just playing music. It's brilliant. But obviously, and like it's a lot more structured. So you sort of turn up, set up, sound check, and it's sort of the pub scene is, it was great for starting out and realizing that like you can't do this if you want to do your own music, because it's too small unless you get over like a bigger like pub venue. And yeah, like the people aren't really listening to you a lot of the time, but you get like 1 in 5, which is brilliant, but most of the time it's sort of not really worth the struggle. But personally, yeah, for me, I'd rather come and sit in like one of the pubs around where I live, so on a little like old low ceiling fireside jam for the night, and that's where I'm sort of at my happiest playing folk music, I think. As a lap steel player around here, because there aren't any that go to these things. There's a lot of guitar players, a lot of fiddle players. So bringing the lap steel, everyone's like, oh, that's cool, that's something new, which is again like a real pleasure, because if you kind of mess up, then they don't really notice, because they don't know the instrument too well. So, yeah, there's just so many brilliant players, and it's just a real pleasure to play with them, sort of week in, week out, really.
Nice. Well, one thing that I've noticed with the Weissenborn in a jam, let's say, you know, like what I'm picturing you're playing at these pubs, you know, just getting together and kind of jamming, is the volume a lot of times on a Weissenborn. It's, I don't know if yours is different than mine, but mine I played, and when it gets a little loud, sometimes the Weissenborn, it's kind of hard to compete, you know?
I mean, that's why I'm now realizing that it's something I've wanted for years. The dobro is sort of the next step for that folk thing, because yeah, when there's sort of 10, 12 musicians and there's fiddles and banjos, like you struggle to get the Weissenborn through. And it's lovely when it's just solo or when it's plugged in, but like literally unplugged in a jam environment, it doesn't really cut it. Whereas the dobro would, it would cut through brilliantly. And I think like the sound is so cool from a dobro, and it's something I cannot wait to get my hands on, because it would just sit so perfectly in that sort of jam scenario, really.
And there's no, but you say that there's, are you basically the only one then playing a lap around, style instrument?
Yeah. I mean, to be honest, a lot of the lap steel the players in the UK are all with Underwood guitars, and I've pretty much met all of them. And there's only really on the main circuit about 5 or 6 of us that are doing it as we are. We're all sort of based around the same area of the country, so it's quite strange, but it's really a great group of people to be a part of. Like, it's a real pleasure. So yeah, when you take it out to a jam, it's sort of not something anyone expects someone to bring along.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
I think getting the dobro would just be sort of a next level thing for me for that folk environment.
Absolutely, it'd be perfect.
Yeah.
I can't even believe I've forgotten to ask this question. But I'm assuming just with the Weissenborn, are you an open D tuning for that one?
I absolutely am. Yeah, D A D F sharp. AD. Something I have been messing around with on a couple of songs at the moment is DAD EAD, which I'm really liking. So it's kind of not really, it's not really anywhere, but it's lovely. Like, I play The Boy That Wouldn't Hoe Corn. I do a little cover of that in that tuning, and you can kind of do a kind of Jerry Douglas style licks with that. And I've got a song of my own that I play in that tuning, and it's really lovely. I mean, most of the time I only really tune that G position string anyway to get different tunings. So I'm either going major or DAD, DAD or minor, really. So it's sort of all on one string, and then the sound just totally changes. So yeah, I'm DAD, DAD for most of the band stuff, and then just capo.
Really?
Yeah.
DAD, DAD. Now is that, I mean, you're lowering that third string.
Yeah.
Pretty considerably. I mean, are you getting, is it wobbly on you?
It depends on the gauge, to be honest. Sometimes it is a bit, and you don't really notice it too much with the amp. But yeah, I mean, if you're playing unplugged, then yeah, it can get a bit wobbly, but to be honest, I don't really notice it. I don't think the natural chorus of those two middle strings are both at D kind of counters it quite a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's
now I forget
like if power chord riffs as well, like with the band, like you can't really mess it up.
For sure. Now any thoughts of going full on lap steel, electric lap steel?
I've thought about it a lot of the time, and I've nearly gone on for it, but I don't know. I don't know. I really want to, but I think what I'm figuring out now, when me and Joe, our guitarist, are sort of talking a lot about it, like if I've got this hollow body, we might as well try and get a bit of that hollow body sound out of it whilst blending an amp tone as well. Mm-hmm. Sort of. I mean, I am so fully into like Robert Randolph. It's unreal. And his tone is just to die for. But I don't know. Like, the only thing that I'd want to get the full body for would be to sort of experiment with sort of standing up, because I sit down for all the gigs. So I'm sitting down with the lap steel sort of rocking out. And I think, like, if I could stand up, the dynamics might change a bit. But then, I don't know, like, it's so difficult because the feedback obviously would be eliminated with a solid body. And it would look a bit cooler, and obviously it's a lot smaller, you can transport it better. But like, I love the hollow necks. Like, I haven't had any problems with them when I've like sat down with the settings in the sound check and got it right. Like, the only time you have feedback problems is when you're sort of really rushing the stage changeovers and you don't have any time to sort of sort it out yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, I'd love to get a solid body eventually, along with the dobro.
Nice.
Great additions to the lineup. Yeah.
Yeah, Bill Asher. I'm sure you've heard of him and his guitars. If you like, Robert Randolph plays one. Lots of different people play one, but he has a pretty affordable one that has that what's called a belly bar in it. So you can it's this bar that have you seen that one?
Can't say I have, no.
Okay, it looks a lot like a Weissenborn, you know, his shape of the instruments. And then there's two holes drilled in the side of it, and he has this removable, what's called a belly bar, that he pushes into the side, and then it allows you to stand up with it, you know, with a strap.
Ooh.
Yeah, man, I think You know, if you ever do,
I've tried putting a strap on the Weissenborn. Yeah. And I don't know if you've heard of them. I'm really into a band called Larkin Poe.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. Megan Lovell.
Yeah. And her lap steel is like, what is that? That is epic. Like, it's got an armrest on it. And I'm just like, oh, I've never seen something so cool. I'm so into those girls at the moment. I love them. I think they're incredible, great songwriters, great performers. And they are like my priority to try and gig with if they're over here. Like, to get to support them would be a real pleasure. It would be amazing. Oh.
Now, have you contacted them at all? Or?
I'm going to this week when the new EP's out, because I found them through a venue. We played the Convent Club, actually, like a couple of weeks after them. And yeah, it's the first time I saw them. I was like, oh, man, that's cool. I really love their sound. Their songs are great. And yeah, I think they're just brilliant musicians.
Now, are they in England now? I thought they were living over
Germany,
there.
Like a couple of days ago, and I know they're coming back to support Elvis Costello, and I think they've got a couple of shows booked in sort of May. So I'm going to try and pull to support the London show. So fingers crossed.
Nice.
That'd be great.
Nice. What's that lap steel that she's playing? Did you do any research on
that? No, like it's awesome. It's like this black and white thing, and it's great, and it's sort of like the bottom like almost wraps around, and it's got
And
I don't know who it's made by. I don't know if it's a custom shop job, but it's really awesome.
You know what, we've got Google right here. Let me type it in here for our listeners. Megan Lovell. So for our listeners, if you don't know, it's he's talking about the band Megan Lovell. Well, the band is called Larkin Poe, and then it's two sisters. And one of the sisters plays lap steel, electric lap steel, and her name's Megan Lovell. So let me see if we can figure it out.
It's in literally all of their promo shots.
Yeah, I see it. I wonder if that's a Supro. Let
me see. I don't know. It looks kind of old, though, but I don't know if that's just because it's been toured so much.
Is that? It might be the Rickenbacker.
It could be. Yeah. I think it is, actually. I think I've read that somewhere. I'm not sure. But yeah, either way, like, she plays a mean slide. And yeah, they're just so talented. I think it's brilliant. Really great, like, new find for me. And not really well known over here in the UK. I talked to a couple of people and they're like, oh, I don't really know them. But I'm trying to turn as many people into them as I can, because I think they're awesome. I'd love to.
Yeah.
Know, like, as soon as possible. It'd be brilliant.
Well, it's very cool, man. You've entered this world, kind of the lap steel or lap instrument world, and I know from experience that there's a lot of really good people in it, you know, you being one of them, and it's a small, kind of close-knit community, and I'm sure if you probably contact her. I've never contacted her, but I know, you know, she's in that kind of nook of dobro and lap steel players.
Yeah, I know that I think they've played with a guy that I supported a while ago called Blair Dunlop, who is a great guitar player himself, and I'm pretty sure they did a record and she played dobro on it. But yeah, it's just a real pleasure to be sort of in the community, you know, and it's nice to talk about the band and try and get us kind of a bit more known in sort of a niche market, rather than just go at it like a blanket and sort of see if anyone will take it. So trying to just talking to you today and getting everyone sort of in the community that you've built as well, just sort of turned on to our tunes, would be brilliant. So yeah, thanks so much, man.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Yeah, I was, you know, so happy to have discovered you, and I think I found out about you definitely through Facebook, but Aaron Radford.
Yes.
Have you?
Yeah, I know. Yeah, I haven't met him yet, but I've done an interview with him as well. Like, he's a super enthusiastic guy. He really cares about the instrument. Yeah, he's a lovely chap. Does a really good job. Really committed. Can't fault him, really.
Yeah, lovely chap.
Like, I think I mean, personally, like, I've been watching your channel for a while. Like, just trying to, when I first started, just trying to find some Weissenborn licks, really, like some more bluesy stuff in open D, which was really quite hard to find, because a lot of them were dobro stuff, sort of open G tuning. So finding an open D one was quite difficult. So I think that's how I came across you guys.
Oh, nice.
So, yeah, it's a real pleasure to talk to you finally.
Yeah, man, for sure. Well, it's great having you on here. Yeah, I'm kind of too, just kind of getting into the open D shapes and patterns and different places where you can play certain things, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of feel like when I get a dobro, I'm going to have to go open G, so that'll be a whole new thing for me. I've never ever tried it, so I've just permanently, because I kind of think that if I tried open G, I have tried open G on a Weissenborn, but it just feels too tense, and I don't trust that it would handle it very well.
So, yeah.
Like, as soon as I get my hands on a dobro, like open G is something I'd love to pick up, especially nice. For if I got a solid body as well, because I think most steel players with solid body are playing open G, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, I keep, I've got a few lap steels. I actually just did a gig this past weekend at a little bar that's about half an hour away from my house and played open D the whole night. And it was a reggae gig.
Really?
And I'm playing.
Cool.
Yeah. And, it just dawned on me that I really need to put out some lessons and just for myself, make diagrams for these patterns for open D.
You know? Yeah, definitely. Like, I know a guy, a band called Echo Town. They play a lot of reggae and they kind of use a lap steel. And yeah, he's got a great tone. His name's Rick. They're good. They're good lads. You should check them out. They're cool. They've got a didgeridoo brothers. And yeah, they're pretty sweet. So yeah, we gigged with them.
What's the name of the band again?
Echo Town.
Echo Town. Okay.
Yeah, they're cool guys. So yeah. The dog at the door.
Well, cool, man. Well, I think, I think we're kind of, I'm all questioned out, but I really thank you for being on the podcast.
Yeah, of course, man. I didn't know if you want to do a quick one about gear.
Oh, sure. Yeah. What kind of gear do you want?
Yeah. It wouldn't be a long section. Just be cool to get it in there.
Yeah. What are you playing through?
Well, amp wise, I'm going through a tiny, like 25 watt, like Fender, little Fender. I don't even know what it is. It's like a little Fender Champ or something, but it has got the best gain I've ever heard on amp, and it's tiny. It goes so loud. But to be honest, most of the time I'm going clean, and I have a wah, and I use a tube screamer, TS9. A bit of delay and a reverb pedal just to add a lot of space to the solos, really. Occasionally I have a Marshall Super Vibe, the chorus pedal, Marshall Governor for like a lot of the heavier riffs. And then I use a Marshall Blues Breaker as like a boost pedal for the solos. But the TS9 is sort of the default setting. So that's on throughout most of the gig. It's never clean. It's just that I kind of treat the TS9 as like the clean setting and then go from there. So I get the tone perfect on there and the drive how I want it. And then everything else is like a boost for the solos or a bit of ambient reverb, really. Nice. Yeah, it's nothing complicated, nice and analog, and that's how I like it.
Very cool. And are you running all these through the same chain, or are you doing an effects loop for like reverb and stuff?
No, it's just one. It's straight out with the guitar and then just a daisy chain through the pedals. Wah goes last for me. No, wah goes before the reverb. So I'd normally go the delay and then the TS9 and then probably the governor, then the chorus. So it's kind of like a bit of an ongoing chain, really. Yeah.
Nice.
Old school, but I love it. I love it.
Yeah. I love pedals. I love gear just to begin with. So, and then you're running through the what amp did you say again? The Fender Champ?
Yeah. I mean, a lot of the time I use a Fender Champion. But when I'm, my little one at home, I bought it off a friend for like 90 quid. It's like a Fender Champion. I think it's like 25 watt, and it's an old one. So it's a solid state, and it is vicious. It's so loud. I love it, and it doesn't ever have any problems. It does the job, and everyone sort of laughs at you when you turn up for a gig and you've got this tiny amp. But it's chronic. and you stick a mic on it, and it holds a candle to anything I've ever played through, and it's so gritty, and it kind of the aesthetic of the band as well, like sort of a rootsy vibe to it. So yeah,
and are you what's your EQ setting on that amp?
Well, because of the I've got a horrible, I'd need to like sort my wah out, but it's a Vox wah, and it adds so much treble. So I take all the treble out of the amp and I put the bass right up, and that's mm-hmm. so I kind of go from there. I get the tone from the pedals and the treble comes from the wah. So the bass is 10 and the treble is 0, and then there's a bit of and then I just try to play with the mids really. Yeah, Everyone looks at the amp and goes, what have you done with that? And it's like, if it changes, then your ears are going to just get shrilled off because it's such a toppy sound with that wah pedal. But as soon as I sort of get the money for a bit more gear, I'll assess the situation. Because it's difficult, like, because I play electric in the set as well. So there's a lot mm-hmm. of changing the settings. So yeah, that's it really. It's nothing fancy. It's a bit ugly, but it does the trick.
Well, very cool. Well, we'll wrap it up here. I wanted to thank you again. Yeah, Barney Kenny, everybody, with check out the Dustbowl Children. Now, let's a little bit. I know you're on Facebook.
Yes. Okay. Facebook. Our Twitter handle is Dustbowl Tweet. Instagram, Facebook, YouTube are all just the band name. You'll see our profile picture is like is our EP cover, so it's like a tweed patch and like a leather trim. So we're pretty easy to find. We're very social, always posting, always on Twitter and Instagram. And we actually have got a band Snapchat now. If any of you guys are on Snapchat, we're Dustbowl Snap. So that'd be super cool. We can nice. Chat.
I'll have to Snapchat you. you'll get a note. I always do Snapchats of my dogs.
So. Sweet. Yeah, let's do it.
Okay, thanks, Barney.
No problem.
And check them out, guys. Okay, take care. Thanks again.